As-salamu alaykum.
My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, continuing inshaAllah ta'ala with the history of the Khulafa al-Rashidin, the four rightfully guided Khulafa, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman and Ali radiallahu anhum. And we began and we finished with regards to the actual bay'ah of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhum, and how the bay'ah was given and the pledge was given to Abu Bakr, and how he became the Khalifa of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and how he became the Amir and the leader of the Muslims after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and how it was a unanimous and a consensus amongst the Muslims that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is the one to be the successor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to take lead of the Muslims after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we mentioned many things that had to do with the actual bay'ah of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and how it took place, and that all the provinces after the bay'ah was given in Medina, all the provinces that were around at the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, the word was sent out and the bay'ah was given to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu with all the Muslims, consensus amongst the Muslims that he is the Khalifa of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now we want to get into how Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, how he ran his khilafah and what principles did he follow in the establishment, or how he began his khilafah radiallahu anhu, because this is something that is new to the Muslims. This is something that they never had, or none of the Muslims had put or had been the burden of being the leader of the Muslims. No Muslim had ever been through it prior to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, because during the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was in control, he was the leader, and he took control of all the matters, and he used to delegate, and he used to send out this companion, that companion, to this province, to that province, take care of all of the judicial systems, of all of the courts, of all of everything. The wahi was being revealed. He took care of everything, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He took care of his family, he took care of his companions. He did everything, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So now Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he's the first to be put in the position of being the leader after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So here Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he's the first to be, that's why he's called Khalifa Rasulillah. That's why he's called the successor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, we mentioned in his first sermon that he gave, he set out the principles for his khilafah and how he's going to run his khilafah. He began by saying that this is a matter that I have never asked, never requested it, during the day or during the night, and it was being given to me, and I am not the best amongst you. And if I obey Allah and His Prophet, then obey me and follow me and help me in the obedience of Allah and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if I go against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the rulings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and against the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then straighten me, advise me, come to me and tell me that you have done something which is wrong. There's a car that is blocking a Honda CRV AWD55F, blocking some cars in the car park. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he set out these principles that if I am to go against the Qur'an or the Sunnah, then to advise me, to straighten me, not to blindly follow, not to follow me blindly even if I'm in the wrong. And then he mentioned the principles that he is going to establish the Khilafah on. Now Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, being the Khalifa, being the human being, and he mentioned in his sermon, in his khutbah, that I am not a messenger or a prophet from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a messenger, he was a prophet, he was receiving revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I am not a prophet or a messenger. I am a human being, I am a man. I am correct and I make mistakes. And he made sure that the people knew this. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, now he wants to establish the internal affairs of the khilafah and how he's going to establish the internal affairs of the Muslimin. That's why Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he set out certain principles that he wanted to establish his khilafah on. So any person, any leader, even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, whenever there was a major issue, even sometimes certain rulings that he hadn't received revelation from yet, he would ask the Sahaba. And he'll do shura with the Sahaba. And he'll ask them what is their opinion. And this is known in the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. If you read the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you'll find that he always asked the Sahaba. So he always had main Sahaba companions who were around him, who advised him. Even when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in some battles, when he took a certain position, a companion would come up to him and would say, "A Prophet of Allah, is this revelation or it's ijtihad or it's personal opinion?" If it's revelation, then we stop and we don't ask any questions or we don't advise. If it's not revelation, then I advise you to do such and such on the battlefield, to go to certain position. And the Prophet ﷺ used to take the advice. Even when the Prophet ﷺ, he wanted to do certain things. For instance, in the battle of Al-Khandaq, the trench, when the Prophet ﷺ, he wanted to make a treaty with the Jews, he came to the leaders of Al-Aws wal-Khazraj, Sa'd bin Mu'ad and Sa'd bin Ubadah. He told them that this is an idea, or this is something that we can do to have a treaty. We give them a certain amount of the crops, of the dates, and we make a treaty between us. Sa'd bin Mu'ad and Sa'd bin Ubadah, they said, if this is revelation, then we follow. If it's not revelation, you are asking us, then we don't accept, and we rather fight them than give up from our crops and from our dates. So even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he used to have, when he had advisors who were with him. And this is any leader out there, any person who wants to lead, he has to have advisors. He has to have people who are with him, who are going to help him, advise him, stand next to him. The leader can't take care of everything. The leader can't do everything himself. There has to be people who are with him, who help him and who advise him. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, this is one of the first things that he established. He brought the companions, the well-known companions, the older companions, he brought them close and he gave them certain positions in the Islamic Khilafah. So he put Abu Ubaid ibn Jarrah radiallahu anhu, this great companion, this is one of the early companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he put him on the ministry of money, on the ministry of finances. Anything that has to do with finances, with wealth, Abu Ubaid ibn Jarrah, he was the minister, he was the wazir of that. And he used to take care of that. Ministry of finances in Islam means what? Meaning that he takes care and overlooks Baytul Mal. And he takes care of Baytul Mal. Baytul Mal is what in Islam? Baytul Mal is the treasury of the Muslims. When the wealth comes in, the sadaqat, when the booty of war comes in, when the zakat comes in, it's all taken to Baytul Mal. And the reason they called it Baytul Mal, because it was literally a house that had the money in it. So they called it Baytul Mal. There was no door, there was no lock, there was no safe with a combination, bodyguards outside. It was a house and the wealth was in the house. And this is why it was called Baytul Mal, the house of money. So Abu Ubaid ibn Jarrah, he was the minister, he used to take care of Baytul Mal. And he used to take care of the finances and was the treasury of the Khalifa of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And he put Abu Bakr, or he put Umar ibn al-Khattab as the minister of justice. Who else can you choose to be minister of justice other than Umar ibn al-Khattab? So he put Umar ibn al-Khattab to be minister of justice, to be the judge. When a dispute comes forward, When there is a problem, an issue between the Muslims, they come to Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. He was the minister of justice. And sometimes even Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he would come himself and sit and take care of issues or take care of disputes or problems. He'll come and he'll do it himself as the Khalifa, as being the Khalifa of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he put Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu, this great companion, he put Zayd ibn Thabit as the minister of communications. Meaning he was the one who used to mainly write the letters for Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He used to be the hand, the writing hand of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He was the main companion. With him, when he wasn't around or when he wasn't able to do that job, he used to have either Uthman radiallahu anhu or Ali radiallahu anhu. So Abu Bakr, he has a team of companions, great companions. Companions who are known for their greatness in Islam and who are known for their firmness and steadfastness on the deen. He didn't put with him any people. He didn't choose any people to be next to him. He didn't choose people who are going to be lenient towards him if he was to rule on something. No, he put men who are going to stand up for the truth and men who are going to be able to recognize what the haq and what the truth is. Men like Abu Ubaidah, Umar, Zayd, Uthman, Ali, great men, he put them next to him and he made them close to him. And this is very important. That's why the famous incident that took place in the time of Ali radiallahu anhu, where a man came to Ali from the Tabi'een. He came to Ali radiallahu anhu and he says that during the time of Abu Bakr, Umar and Uthman, there wasn't that great dispute between the Muslims as there is in your times. So Ali radiallahu anhu, he looked at him and said, do you know what the main reason of this is? He said, what? He said, the main reason is that Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman had men like me who stood next to them, who were with them, who fought for them, who stood up for the truth with them. And I have men like you who complain. And I have men like you who talk and complain, but don't want to be there when they are needed, or to stand up when they are needed to stand up. For Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he put these men next to him. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, as we know, he was a merchant. So now he's got these great Sahaba next to him. One Sahaba is justice of the Minister of Justice, the Minister of the Treasury. One of them, communications. He's set up a solid foundation for his khilafah. But Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, it's not like the systems that we have today. You become leader, you become president, or you become the prime minister of a country. The house is already there, the mansion is already there, the salary is already there, that you don't need to worry about anything. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he became the Khalifa, and he used to go to the market and sell. He was a merchant. He would go to the market, buy in the morning, and then he would sell. And that was his way, means of wealth that he used to gain. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, the Sahaba, they saw the importance of freeing up the time of Abu Bakr. You can't be the leader, the Khalifa of the Muslimin, the leader of the Muslimin, and you have to go, and a large amount of time of the day, you're going to spend it in selling, buying, and making your means, because you have wives, children that you have to take care of. So they saw that they have to free up Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and give him a salary, give him a means to eat, for he was a merchant. So they have to replace his wages with something that he can take from Bayt al-Mal al-Muslimin. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he used to go out to the market in the morning, buy, and then he'll come and he'll sell. So he was met by Umar and Abu Ubaidah al-Jarrah radiallahu anhumah. So they said to him, he was going to the market. They said, where are you going, O Khalifa of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said, to the market. He said, what are you going to do in the market? And you've been given the position of the Khalifa of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You are the leader of the Muslims. What business do you have going to the market? So he said, from where do I feed my family? If I don't go to the market and make my ends meet, how am I going to feed my family? I don't have a treasure, a bank account that I have saved up waiting for this day to come. I don't have a pension that I've been waiting. I've saved on the side, the superannuation that I've saved on the side. I don't have that. I go out, I make my ends meet, I feed my family, I come home. This was Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. This was the way, this was the tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with regards to tawakkul, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, إِذَا تَوَكَّلْتُمْ أَوْ لَوْ تَوَكَّلْتُمْ عَلَى اللَّهِ حَقَّ تَوَكُّلِهِ. If he's really had tawakkul, trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way or the true tawakkul, trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَرَزَقَكُمْ كَمَا يَرْزُقُ الطَّيْرِ. He will sustain you, give you the sustenance, the rizq, the same way he gives the bird the rizq. تَغْدُوا خِمَاصًا وَتَغْدُوا بِطَارًا وَتَرْجَعْ خِمَاصًا. It goes out in the morning, empty stomach, then it comes in the afternoon with a full stomach. That's the tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, it's very easy for him to give up his wealth for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the story is known, when he gave up his wealth, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what did you leave for your family? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he said the statement that is said until the day of judgment, تَرَكْتُ لَهُمُ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولُهُ. I left for them Allah and His Prophet. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you have not left anything, or you can't leave anything better than Allah and His Prophet. There's nothing better that you can leave than Allah and His Prophet. فأبو بكر رضي الله عنه says, where am I going to feed my family from? How am I going to give my family the sustenance that they need? They said, come to us or come with us. If this is the case, then come with us. Let us set an amount of money for you. If this is the case, let us set an amount of money for you. So they went with Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه. And in the narrations, it mentions that he was given 250 dinar a year, 250 dinar a year, and a sheep without the stomach and the head and the bones, or in the feet. So it wasn't a full sheep, certain portions of the sheep were taken out. Every day a sheep without the stomach, the head and the feet, and 250 dinar a year. 250 dinar a year, yani less than a dinar a day. Less than a dinar a day. So this was given, or this is what they agreed to give Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. But this wasn't enough. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he has a big family. A lot of kids. Doesn't have one wife. He has more than one wife. He's got many kids. So for him to take care of his family on this small wage, on the small amount that they gave him, it wasn't enough. So when he saw it and it wasn't enough, he returned the money to Baytul Mal al-Muslimin, to the treasury. He returned it without them knowing, and he continued to do his trading and his buying and selling in the market. But what he did this time is that he went to al-Baqir, and he went out where they might not see him, and he started to trade, and he started to sell that which he had bought, because the wage that they had given him wasn't enough. The wage that they had given him, it wasn't enough for him to take care of his family. So he said, I'll put the money back, I'll put that which they gave me back, and I'll work myself, and I'll earn myself, and I'll take care of my family. So when they came, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he went out to the Baqir. He started to buy and sell in the Baqir. So a group of women, they came to the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they're sitting in there waiting. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he comes past and he sees these women sitting, and he says, what do you want? What's the problem? He says, we want the Khalifa of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to sit or to come and to take care of a matter that has happened between us. We are waiting for the Khalifa of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he goes and he's looking for Abu Bakr. He says, where are you, Abu Bakr? There are people who are waiting for you. You are the leader of the Muslims now. You have to take care of their affairs. They are waiting for you to take care of their affairs. He says, I'm not in need of the whole imara that you have given me. He says, that which you have gave me, the sustenance you have gave me is not enough. So I put it back and I'm going to buy and sell on my own. So they said to Abu Bakr, okay, it's not enough. How much is enough? What do you need for you to be comfortable, for you to be able to feed your family, to take care of your family? He said 300 dinar a year and a full sheep a day. One whole sheep a day. So they came to Ali radiallahu anhu and they said, oh Ali, this is what he's asking for. Do you find it appropriate? Is this good enough? He says, give it to him. If he wants more, give him more. His position that he is in, the worth of his position that he's in is much greater than that. Give him enough for him to be able to sustain, to take care of his family. So they put 300 dinar a year and one whole sheep a day. He said, are you pleased with this? I am pleased. And that was his wages. That was the wages of the Khalifa of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now if you try to calculate 300 dinar to our days today, it will probably be the minimum wage of our days today. The minimum wage of a person of our days today. And this was who? This was the Khalifa. This was the leader of the Muslims. This was the one who's put in the front of everyone. This is the one that if he goes wrong, he is the one who is blamed in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not everyone else. So his position is a great position. And his position is a very high position. But the wages was to what we need. This is how much you need. This is how much we will give you. This is how much he took. And if it was more than what he needed, he would return it to Bayt Mal al-Muslimin. And if a year came past and he didn't need the 300, the rest of it, he'll give it back to Bayt Mal al-Muslimin. This is how trustworthy, and this is how they dealt with the trust that they were given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now if you go and you look at the recent issues that took place in the Islamic world, the Arab world, don't care about the European, don't care about the Western, the Arabs, the Muslims themselves, the people who have been put in positions, the wealth that they had outside of their countries was more than the wealth that the whole country had. Why? Because they used the position to gain the worldly wealth. And they had millions, billions of dollars that they took and they used, and this wealth that they had put overseas, the Western countries, they were the ones who were benefiting from it, while the people or the Muslims are starving and they don't have enough food or enough wealth to live or sustain themselves. So this trust, these Sahaba radiallahu anhum, this trust that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them, they upheld it. And they stood firm and they didn't take advantage. They didn't take advantage. That's why one of the worst lies and accusations that were done upon Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is that he took the property or the inheritance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as I mentioned in the lessons before, he took it for himself and he benefited from it for himself. This is one of the biggest accusations that they did to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and to Umar, that they took advantage of the properties and that which was left behind by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he ate from food that there was shubha in the food, it could have been halal or it could have been haram. When he knew that there was a shubha in the food, he made himself vomit. And he took that food out of his system. He said, I don't want this food to remain in my system. This is how trustworthy they were. This is how the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they took care of their affairs. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he was, if not the most trustworthy, one of the trustworthiest companions. And his name, his nickname is what? As-Siddiq. His nickname is As-Siddiq. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, as we said, he was given 300 dinar a year with one sheep every day. One sheep every day for himself, his family, and his children, and for him to be able to sustain himself for the whole year. And 300 dinar, as we said, is not a great amount. It's not a great amount. The lowest prime minister or leader in the countries today, go look and go research and see how much their wages are. How much their wages are. And the palaces that they live in and the places that are set for them. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he became Khalifa, he lived in his same house and he traveled the same way, and he was not given anything extra except for the wages and the small amount of wages that he was given. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, the Khalifa of the Muslimin, he wasn't someone who, when he became the Khalifa, he secluded himself from the community and he didn't interact with the community. And he didn't continue to do the actions that he used to do before he became the Khalifa and before he became the leader of the Muslims. For knowing Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he had many actions and helpful actions that he used to do to others within the community at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that no one else knew about. So how was Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu even after he became Khalifa, how was he with the community? One of the most famous things and known things of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is that he used to milk the sheep and the goats for the people of his area, for the orphans of his area and the children of his area. He used to milk their goats, and he used to sit down every time in the morning. He'll sit down and he'll milk the goats for the people of his area. So after he became the Khalifa or the Amir al-Mu'mineen, a young girl, she comes up to Abu Bakr and she says, Abu Bakr, she says, now that you've become the Khalifa, you're not going to milk our goats for us anymore. Now that you've become the Khalifa of the Muslimin, you're not going to milk our goats anymore. He said, by Allah, I'm going to milk it for you and I'll continue to milk it for you. And I wish and I make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not change me because of the position that I have been given, or does not change a manner or a deed that I used to do before because of the position that he has put me in. He says, I make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't take away those good deeds and those actions that I used to do. He says, I'll come and I'll milk the goats for you and I'll ask you, do you want it frothy or do you not want it frothy? Do you want it with bubbles, yani, the milk, or not? And if they wanted it either way, he used to do it for them. And this is the Khalifa of the Muslimin. This is the leader of the Muslimin, the one who has the most important position in the Muslimin. But this is something that shows the humbleness of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And as long as he was in his house, which was not in the center of Medina, he continued to do that until he moved to Medina, until he left that area and he moved to Medina. So he continued to do these actions even after he became the Khalifa of the Muslimin for the 6 months that he lived in that area that he used to live in before the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu has been mentioned many times for the extra actions that he used to do. The famous story that is mentioned about Abu Bakr is about the old blind lady. That Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he used to go to her house every day, take care of her affairs, fix her house for her, clean her house, and then leave. And this was something that him and Umar radiallahu anhu used to compete over. Who will be able to get there first? Who will be able to get to her house first? She's an old lady, blind, doesn't have anyone to take care of her. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he heard of the situation, he took it upon himself, I am going to take care of her affairs. Anything she needs, it's upon me. And when Umar radiallahu anhu, he heard about it, they used to compete. And Umar radiallahu anhu says that I never was able to get there except that Abu Bakr had already been there and had finished the work. Even after he became the Khalifa of the Muslimin, he continued to do that for that old lady. He continued to visit her house, see what she needs, take care of her affairs, even after he had become the Khalifa of the Muslimin. And the famous, or that which we mentioned, when he visited Umm Ayman, when he was sitting with Umar, he said, Umar, let's go visit Umm Ayman. She used to be, when the Prophet ﷺ was young, she used to take care of the Prophet ﷺ, or the kids of the Prophet ﷺ. So the Prophet ﷺ, he used to visit her when he was alive. So Abu Bakr says to Umar, he says, let's get up, let's go and visit Umm Ayman, the way the Prophet ﷺ used to visit her. So they went and they visited her, the famous story 9. When she saw them, she started to cry. And Abu Bakr and Umar, they said, why are you crying for? The Prophet ﷺ is in a better place. He's with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, I'm not crying because of that. He says, I'm crying because with the death of the Prophet ﷺ, the revelation has stopped. The connection between the heavens and the earth has stopped. So when she said that, فَهِيَجَتْهُمَا عَلَى الْمُكَاءِ, then Abu Bakr and Umar, they started to cry themselves. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, in the community, he remained the way he was. There was people in need, he used to go and he used to help them, that were people that were in need. And this is how he continued to be radiallahu anhu. His advice, he used to give advice to the people. Whenever he would see someone, he used to give them advice. He used to come up to them. There was a lady who she had promised, or she'd made an oath not to speak. She had made an oath not to speak. So when Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he came to her, he said that, why are you not speaking? He said, I have intended a hajj, and a hajj that I am silent in. She said to her, speak, for verily this is from the actions of the Jahiliyyah. To make an oath not to speak at all, the good, the bad, or anything beneficial, unbeneficial, to say silent altogether, this is something that is not from the actions of Islam. So she said, so she spoke. She said, who are you? She asked Abu Bakr, who are you? He said, I am a man from the Muhajireen. Said, what Muhajireen? Said, from Quraysh. He said, I am from Quraysh. Said, from what tribe in Quraysh? She said, what tribe from Quraysh? He said to her, Innaki Nasa'ud. He said to her, you're a woman who asks a lot of questions. Why are you asking a lot of questions for? Who are you? I'm a man from the Muhajireen. What Muhajireen? Quraysh. What tribe from Quraysh? You're asking too many questions. Why are you asking so many questions for? She said, I am Abu Bakr. He said to her, I am Abu Bakr. She said, O Khalifa of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how long will we remain on the good of the deen? How long will we remain on this? After that which we have gone, or that which we have left from the Jahiliyyah, how long are we going to stay on the good? How long are we going to stay on the righteous deed and the righteous way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? So he said to her, بَقَاءُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ مَسْتَقَامَتْ بِهِ أَئِمَّتُكُمْ. He said that you remain on the good as long as your leaders remain on the good. He said, you remain on the good as long as your imma, your leaders, remain on the manners or on the ways of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She said, what is the imma? Who are these leaders? He said, did your people not have leaders and honorable people that will order them or will order their followers to do something and they will obey? She said, yes. He said, these are the leaders and those are the imma of the people. People who have been given a position of leadership and a position of power. That's why one of the signs of the Day of Judgment is that the positions of power, the positions of leadership will be given to people who are not fit to be in those positions. Who are not fit to be in a position of leadership, in a position or a trust of leadership. This is one of the signs of the Day of Judgment. Another sign is that the people themselves, the general people themselves, they will take ignorant people as their leaders. If there's no one there, they'll take ignorant people as their leaders. تَخَذَ النَّاسُ رُؤُوسًا جَهَالًا. Ignorant people. فَضَلُّوا وَأَضَلُّوا. They go astray and they send the people astray. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he continued to do these actions that he used to do during the time of the Jahiliyyah. He's concerned to enjoin what is good and forbid what is evil. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, during his khilafah, he didn't forget al-amr bil-ma'roof wal-nahi anil-munkar. He didn't forget to enjoin that which is good and to forbid that which is evil. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he explained to the people what the meaning or the misunderstanding that the people had over certain verses. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you who believe, upon you is the responsibility of yourselves. Alaykum anfusakum. Upon you is the responsibility of yourselves. Those who have gone astray will not harm you. If or when you have been guided, those who have gone astray won't harm you. The people who are doing the bad won't harm you as long as you are guided. He said, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he say, if people see an evil action and do not change it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send the punishment upon them. So the people, they took the understanding of, if yourself you are guided, then the people who are misguided won't harm you, or the people who are doing the bad won't harm you. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, no, this is not the understanding of the verse. The understanding of the verse is that if people see an evil action, if you see an evil action that the people are doing and you do not change it, or you do not try to rectify it, to change it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send the punishment on everyone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send the punishment on everyone. That's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was asked that will the people be punished for the bad that they do, and amongst them there are righteous people, he said yes. He will start with the righteous people, because they didn't enjoy the good and forbid the bad. They stood by themselves, they stayed by themselves, concealed themselves, sat by themselves, they saw the bad, the evil happening. Alaykum anfusakum. Keep yourself or keep, be concerned only by yourself. So this is an understanding of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. As he says in another narration, he says, O people, you recite this verse, but you do not understand it as it should be understood. We heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, if the people see a wrongdoer and they do not stop him, soon Allah will punish them all. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in another verse that explains this verse, he says, يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا فِتْنَةً لَا تُصِيبَنَّ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْكُمْ خَاصَّةً. Fear, are you believers, fear a fitna, a trial, a tribulation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that will not befall or will not come upon those who are oppressed amongst his own. When the adhab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sent down, it's a general adhab. It's a general punishment. Look overseas. Look what is happening to the people overseas. Most of them, the majority of the people, are general people, are normal people who are living their life. But when the adab, when the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes down, the punishment comes down on everyone. It comes down on everyone. And Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala says, with regards to the verse that we mentioned, this is not contrary to the obligation of enjoining what is good and forbidding what is bad. Because the correct view of the meaning of the verse, according to the scholars, is if you do what is enjoined upon you, if you do what is your responsibility to enjoin the good, forbid the bad, the shortcomings of others will not affect you. And if you go and you call and you advise and you enjoin the good and you forbid the bad, whether the people accept or agree or follow or adhere to your da'wah, to your call, to your advice or not, now you don't have any harm upon you. Now you are from the ones, alaykum anfusakum, you will not be harmed by the misguidance of the people. But after you have enjoined the good and forbidden the bad. That's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in another hadith, he says, لَتَأْمُرُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَلَتَنْهَوُنَّ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. You will enjoin the good, فعل أمر, an order. You enjoin the good and forbid the bad. أَوْ لَيُشِكَنَّ اللَّهَ أَنْ يَنْزِلَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْذِلَّ. Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or kama qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He will send upon you the disgrace, the dishonor. And you will not be lifted even if the righteous of you make dua. Even if the righteous amongst you call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you have left the good, or left enjoining the good and forbidding the bad. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he says that this verse was misunderstood. And why is that? Because the people began to only be concerned about themselves. That's why when the person sees something bad or an evil action or something that displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala happen, a sin, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that if you see a munkar taking place, to change it with your hand. If you have the responsibility, the responsibility, the right to change something by your hand, then you change it by your hand. You change it by your hand, if you're able to change it. The father in his family, the leader in his community, the person who has been given a position to change things or to change the munkar with their hand. If you don't or are not able to do it with your hand, then with your mouth, with your tongue, speak, inform, advise, call the people, let the people know. Tell the people what is happening, what wrong is going on, or the sin that they are doing. And to do it in the best of ways. To give da'wah in the best of ways. وَدْعُوا إِلَى سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنِ. Call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with what? بِالْحِكْمَةِ, wisdom. And the beautiful call or the beautiful speech, مَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنِ. The beautiful call, the beautiful speech. حتى the kuffar, the disbelievers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنِ. And debate them. Speak with them in the way that is best. بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنِ. So the wisdom, the da'wah, the calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a call or is a path that has, the person has to have wisdom, has to have hikmah. Has to have hikmah upon what they do. If you can't with your tongue, you're not able to. You're not able to speak, then to hate it in your heart. To hate it in your heart. And the Messenger of Allah says, وَذَٰلِكَ أَضْعَفُ الْإِيمَانِ. That is the weakest point of Iman. That is the weakest point of Iman. Now look at the position of the Muslims today. Look at the position of the Muslims today. If that is the weakest point of Iman, then see yourself. If you see a munkar, if you see something bad taking place, a sin, something that displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it doesn't even move your heart, you don't even hate it in your heart, then you are beyond or you are below the level of weakness, the weakest level of Iman. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. If you see the bad, you hear of the bad, you hear of the munkar taking place, and you don't hate it in your heart, doesn't affect you in your heart, then you are below the lowest level of Iman that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. Why? And this usually happens when you are surrounded by it, you become accustomed to something. When you're always around something, you become accustomed to it. Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned something very beautiful about being accustomed or being around something. He says, he gives an example of the people who don't pray and the people who don't fast. He says, you find that the people that pray, because it's done five times a day, you're around someone who doesn't pray, it becomes sort of normal. At the beginning you advise that if it continues, it becomes normal. They don't pray, khalas, they don't pray. You're able to still hang around with them and sit with them. And then he says, those same people that don't pray, when the month of Ramadan comes, if people see them not fasting for one day, they'll go off at them. And they'll say, what are you doing? Why aren't you fasting? Why aren't you doing this one? But the person, you've been around him for years and he doesn't pray. Just because he breaks the fast once, this is something that you are not accustomed to. Him not praying, you become accustomed to it. But then him not fasting, this is something that you find strange. It's weird. That's why even in our days today, you find there's people, there's many people, وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. Unfortunately, in the Muslim Ummah today, there's many people who don't pray. There's many people, youth, old, people who don't pray. There's people who are 50, 60 years old, they don't even know how to pray. unfortunately. This youth, these days, 20, younger, 16, 17, they don't even know how to make wudu. Don't even know how to pray. And this is the greatest of sins after associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to not pray. Out of laziness, out of pride, for whatever reason it is. The person, no matter what the person is doing, the one thing that the person should never leave is salat. Should never leave, no matter how bad you are, no matter how big the wrong you are doing, never leave salat. Never leave salat. The salat is that thing that will keep you in line, that will keep you around. Once the person leaves salat, then the person is on a very dangerous path. That person is a very dangerous path. Never leave the salat. But Abu Bakr, the smallest, the enjoining the good, forbidding the bad, this is something that the smallest that the person has to have, or the smallest thing the person has to have, is to hate it in their heart. If you don't hate it in your heart, then you're below the lowest levels of Iman. From the advices, one very important thing that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, being the Khalifa, is that he used to always give sermons, he used to always advise the people. And if you read the sermons of Abu Bakr, you'll find that they are words of gold. They are beautiful sermons, words that are from the heart. Words that are from the heart, advice to the Muslims. That's why one of the main components of da'wah, of speaking, of calling people, is to have the love of Allah and the love of His Prophet in your heart. And through that love, even if you say one, two words, when you read the sermons of the Prophet ﷺ, of the Sahaba, it's a half a paragraph, a page if it's long, short in words. But even if it's short and it's from the heart and it's sincere and it's said in the appropriate way, it can do more than a half an hour lecture. That's why the sermons of the Prophet ﷺ were short. His sermons were short, direct, straight to the point. Straight to the point. One of the sermons, one of the beautiful sermons of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he says, there are five kinds of darkness and five kinds of light. There are five kinds of darkness and five kinds of light. He says, love for this world is darkness. To have love for this world, attached to this dunya, to this world, is darkness. And the light for it is piety, is taqwa. The light for that darkness is taqwa. He says, sin is a darkness. The sin, when a person sins, it's darkness. And the light for it is what? Repentance. The light for it is repentance. He says, the grave is darkness. Literally, metaphorically, is darkness, the grave. One of the things, the first thing that you will face of the unknown, of the unseen, of the ghaib, is the grave. The first thing that you will face, the first step of leaving this life is the grave. That's when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that if the position in the grave, if your position in the grave goes good, goes well, then that's an indication of the akhirah being good and well. But if it begins bad in the grave, then you can only imagine what the rest is going to be like. What the rest is going to be like. So the darkness, the grave is darkness. What's the light of the grave? And the light of the grave is La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah. This is the lightness of the grave. It says the hereafter is darkness. And the light for it is the righteous deeds. Is the a'mal, is the actions that you do. He says the sirat is darkness. The sirat, the bridge over Jahannam, the sirat that everyone will have to pass. He says the sirat is darkness, and the light for it is certainty of faith. Strong iman, strong faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of these darknesses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's a light that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put for it. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as he always advised, Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he always sat with the Sahaba, always advised them, always spoke with them. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he continued that legacy.
And whenever he could, he would sit with the Sahaba and he would advise them. Whenever he did, they would call out as-salatu jami'ah, that the salat is in congregation or the congregation is in attendance. So everyone would come to the masjid and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu would speak. And he would advise the Sahaba and he would continuously advise the Sahaba. The judicial system in the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was built on certain principles. And he only chose those companions that he had trust in their knowledge and the extensive of knowledge and their sitting or being around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For the judicial system at the time of Abu Bakr was built upon the Quran, the Sunnah, the consensus, the ijma' of the Sahaba of that time, the ijtihad, the personal reasoning, personal opinion of the Sahaba, if nothing is found in the Quran or the Sunnah, or there's no consensus. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he will do ijtihad. And this was something, an ijtihad that goes back upon the Quran and the Sunnah. From the understanding of the Quran and the Sunnah, the ijtihad comes. If there was no text found in the Quran or in the Sunnah or in the consensus, even Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he didn't know of a certain ruling, he didn't say that if I don't know it, then no one else knows it. A female came to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and she asked about the inheritance of the grandmother. He said, I do not know anything from the Quran or the Sunnah that mentions the grandmother. So he called the Sahaba and he went up to the Sahaba and asked him. He said, has anyone heard anything with regards to the grandmother and her inheritance? And Mughira bin Shu'bah, he got up and he said, yes, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that she gets the sudus, that she gets 1/6 in the absence of the mother. She gets the sudus. So Abu Bakr, he says, does anyone else witness to this? Muhammad ibn Maslam gets up, he says, I witness to this, Abu Bakr. So he gave her sudus. So the judicial system of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, it was shura. It was sitting with the Sahaba. If he didn't know something from the Quran or the Sunnah or the Ijma', he'll go out to the Sahaba and he'll ask the Sahaba. And this is how Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he established the judicial system. And all the provinces that were around outside of Medina, and even when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he passed away, it wasn't only Medina that the Muslims were in. Medina was the center of the Khilafah. But 300, 400 kilometers south, there was Mecca, which is a big city on itself. More down south is Yemen, which is also one of the places that became Muslim. Hadramaut, which was considered as itself, Oman, Bahrain, Najd. There were different provinces that were around that the Prophet ﷺ had assigned people or Sahaba to them to take care of the affairs. And the main affairs that these people used to take care of first and foremost was the prayer. The Amir that was sent to a certain place, the first thing that they had to do was Salat and the Sermon of Friday. And in those days, during those days, there used to be one masjid. In every area, there's one masjid which is called Al-Masjid Al-Jami'. The masjid that when there's khutbah of Jum'ah, when there's Eid sermons, that's the only masjid that is open. Or that's the only masjid that is used. That's why when you come to the conflict, like what we have on this Eid, Eid falls on what? Eid falls on the Friday. So we have a sermon in the morning, then we have the Friday khutbah. Do you have to go to both, or you don't have to go to both, or you don't? The difference of opinion behind this, the principle of it goes back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he did Salat al-Eid and he did the sermon and the people came from the villages, the people came from outside of Medina. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, what? Whoever wishes to not come back for Salat al-Jum'ah, then he's in that option of not coming back. or he has that option of not coming back. But what did he say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said, فَإِنَّا مُجَمِّعُونَ, or for verily we are going to do Jum'ah. And in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he did the Friday or the sermon of Eid, the Salat al-Eid, when it was on a Friday, he gave the excuse for the ones who traveled to come to the Jum'ah or to come to the Eid prayer. He gave them the excuse not to attend or not having to attend. But when the time for the Friday came, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did the khutbah. He did the Friday sermon and he prayed Jum'ah and he prayed Jama'ah. But he gave the excuse for the people not to attend. That's why even the ulama who say that you don't have to attend the Friday sermon or the Jum'ah prayer if it falls on the same day as Eid, they say that if the person is around or the person is able to, then it's better for him to witness the Jama'ah. Then it's better for him to go to the Jama'ah, to the Jum'ah. That's why some of the ulama, the Ahnaf and the Maliki, they say that, especially nowadays, today, that if it falls on a Jum'ah, then you have to go to Jum'ah. It's not enough that you just go to Salat al-Eid. It's not enough that you just go to Salat al-Eid. But that is the essence of the difference of opinion between the ulama. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, whoever doesn't want to come, he doesn't have to come, but we are going to do Jum'ah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did Jum'ah. So one of the main jobs of the wulat, of the ones who were assigned to the provinces, was to lead the prayer, to do the Friday sermons, and to do the Eid sermons, and to continue, and to do the jobs of leading the Muslims. That's why Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he became the Khalifa, automatically he's now the leader, or he's the Imam of the Masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he's the Khatib of the Masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He can delegate, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to delegate some certain actions. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after the opening of Mecca, he only did Hajj once. Before that, who did he send to take care of Hajj? Abu Bakr. So the Amir, the leader, can delegate all the leaders, all the Umara of the provinces that were around at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he kept them the same. He didn't change anyone that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had assigned to a certain area. Some areas were combined, he gave the choice to some of the Sahaba to go to here or to go to there, but the majority of them, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he stepped or he kept the same people who the Prophet ﷺ had assigned. He didn't change anyone that the Prophet ﷺ had assigned. He kept them there, he didn't want to change anything that the Prophet ﷺ had done. Anything, even to the smallest of things, or even to just assigning a leader or an Amir. And this goes to show the sincerity of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. The first thing leaders do today, at least in the Arab countries, and in the countries that they have this way of thinking, is that as soon as they're given a position of power, they always bring close to them their what? Their family and their people. They always try to give their closest family the most gain and the most ability to take or to gain the wealth from the ummah. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, that's why when we come to the seerah of Uthman, one of the things they accused Uthman with was that he assigned his own family. And he gave extra to his own family, to his close family. And they started to accuse him of this. So this is with regards to how Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and this is only a small amount of what can be mentioned with regards to how he established the principles he set for his khilafah and his leadership to begin now on the road of taking care of the affairs of the Muslims and continuing the legacy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And one of the first things, as we'll mention next week, one of the first things he did is that he continued and he didn't stop the army that the Prophet ﷺ was sending to the north, was sending to the Romans, which was the army in the leadership of Usama ibn Zaydin, the son of the loved one of the Prophet ﷺ. Usama ibn Zayd is the son of Zayd bin Haritha. Zayd bin Haritha is known as Hibbu Rasulillah, the one who was beloved to the Prophet ﷺ. Usama ibn Zayd, Usama the son of Zayd bin Haritha, is the Hibbu ibn Hibbu Rasulillah. Is the loved one, the son of the loved one of the Prophet ﷺ. And Usama ibn Zayd, as we said, he was 18 18 years old, when he was given the leadership by the Prophet ﷺ, the first thing that Abu Bakr did after his khilafah, after establishing principles, is that he sent out or he continued the army of Usama, and we'll speak about that inshallah next week, how it took place and the issues or the issues that came up or arise with regards to the army of Usama. Inshallah ta'ala, we'll mention that next week. Just finally, as we all know, the day of Arafah is on Thursday, inshallah, for the ones who are following the global moon sighting. For those who are following the local moon sighting, their Arafah will be on Friday. Anyways, the day of Arafah, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, it's sunnah to fast the day of Arafah. He said, أحسب على الله, that I think, or I say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive the sins of a previous year and a year to come. So the day of Arafah, make sure that you fast. If you haven't been fasting the 10 days or the 9 days of the Hijjah, make sure that you fast at least the day of Arafah. Make sure that you fast at least the day of Arafah, that you can attain this reward and the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that which we are all in need of, and we all need the rahmah and the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanahu wa bihamdik, wa shahadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.
We are one, no mama, who should stand with each other through all the highs and lows.